Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. It's a great pleasure for me to be back in this season. So in this talk, I would like to explain how to use the geometry of independent logarithmic slices to study some interesting problems on W algebras, which are certain vertex algebras. And some of our motivations come from recent conjecture in physics in the context of 4D, 2D duality. So actually, these nilpotent Slodovich slices are quite standard object in representation theory. And in my first part, I will review some facts about them without talking about vertex algebra for a moment, because they are of independent interest. And then I will explain how they appear in the context of vertex algebras as associated varieties of vertex algebras. So I will explain this in the second part in a more general context, and then go to the context of W algebras, because actually they appear as associated varieties of W algebras. And then I will talk about the problem I will be interested in, so this last part will be a bit more advanced. I will talk about collapsing level for W algebras. And I will explain our results, but also our motivation. So probably this will be in the second talk. All right, so for the first part, let me introduce some notations. Okay, so let me introduce some notation. So in my talk, G will be a simple Lie algebra. And the ground field will be always C. All right, so G will be a Lie algebra of some algebraic group G, and G acts on its Lie algebra and on its dual. And then I denote by N the nilpotent, the set of nilpotent elements of G, which are the elements such that this is zero for R big enough. Okay, so this is the element such that this is a nilpotent, and this is referred to the nilpotent code of G, because it's conical. Right, so it is well known that N is a finite union of G orbits. So I guess it is well known for everybody. If G is SLN, then this is just a traceless Lie algebra with a bracket given by commutator of matrices. And then N in this case is really the set of nilpotent matrices. And then orbits are just conjugative classes, and this is a well-known result. All right, so now I pick an orbit, nilpotent orbit, so let's say Gx. And then nilpotent Slodovich slices arise when we want to study singularities of the closure of the orbit, which is now singular varieties. And it is known that the singular locus of this closure, it is just a complement to the orbit in the closure. So the general result is due to Namikawa using a result of Kaledin. It is well known for type A and even classical cases. But surprisingly, this is quite recent result in general. So anyway, so the singular locus is this, and then I pick a nilpotent element in this singular locus. And then if we want to understand the local geometry of this closure at F, it's good to have what we call a transversal slice. So maybe I recall what is a transversal slice, and what it is very nice in the context of Lie algebra is that such a slice always exists. So this is what I want to explain. All
So maybe I recall that if you have in general X, G variety, then a transversal slice so let's say you pick X in X, so a transversal slice in X at X, what is this? It is a locally closed subset, let's say S in X, which contain your point X, such that if you look at the morphism just given by this, you require that this morphism is smooth at one X. And then plus usually it is required that S is the smaller is the smallest as possible. The dimension of S is smallest as possible. Plus is smallest as possible with these conditions satisfied. All right.
Sorry, you were saying that S was a set. I mean, should it be like some variety, or what do you mean?
A priori, just locally closed, but in the context of nilpotent orbit, it will be an affine space.
Yeah, but but you still have a dimension, right?
Ah, it's dimension as a variety. It's just dimension as a variety. It's usually required that you take the smallest as possible among variety which satisfies that. And then you have a transversal slice, and obviously, up to smooth equivalence, the singularity of x at your point, small x, is the same as s at this point. So when we study singularities...
Maybe I'm still confused, because if I just take s to be a point, doesn't it satisfy your conditions? Yeah, it shouldn't.
It should not.
Yeah, because it should be like, I don't know, it should contain an open neighborhood of S, right? Something. I mean,
you need indeed what I should add. Yeah, you're right.
Smooth in the sense of algebraic geometry.
Yeah, smooth in the sense.
It's submersion, and with a point, it's not a submersion, right? Because with a point, it's inclusion of the slice, which is not a submersion, so it's not smooth.
Yeah, what Anton suggests is just a point. Yeah. And then, it will be not smooth because the image will be just a point. So it will be not smooth as an algebraic morphism. Okay? And then, in this case, it is obvious that you have a variety here, exactly G cross S. So maybe I can write, but you have this. So here it's the same map, and here it's just a projection. And here you apply this, and then these two morphisms are smooth in one X, and then in this case we say that the singularity at X in X is the same as the singularity at S in X.
Probably I don't understand, what does it mean smooth?
Okay, smooth, it's a smooth morphism, okay, I don't want to... this means essentially it's a submersion. The differential is a submersion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, yeah, and when you want to... So as I said, this is also a notion of smooth equivalence. So up to smooth equivalence, the singularity at X in the point X is the same as the singularity as S in at the point X. So when people want to understand the singularities of this at this point, they try to find the transversal slice of this at F. And now I claim that this always exists in the context of nilpotent orbit. Maybe this I don't really need for the talk. Okay, so such a slice always exists for the closure.
I'm a little bit still confused with that. There we have sort of two varieties somehow.
Yeah.
So the smooth one and the singular subset.
No, but let me finish.
So which one X, which one...
No, but let me finish. I will explain what is a slice, but the corresponding slice will be the intersection of the closure with S.
So S, but we should think of S as being in G or in the orbit?
I will explain, but okay. S a priori is in the whole G, so this is not what we want.
So I intersect the slice that I will explain what it is
with the closure.
Otherwise, it does not lie in your orbit. And this is how nilpotent pseudo-V slice appear. So let me just explain what is the slice for the moment. Does exist. So for the moment, I say for that, but let me explain first how to construct a general slice. So by the Jacobson-Morozov theorem, you can embed F into an SN2 triple. So this generates a Lie algebra of type SN2. And then you take for, let's say, SF to be F plus GE, where this is the centralizer of E in G. So this is just a priori an affine space for the moment. And this one is transversal to the nilpotent orbit of F, or even of the closure. So in the sense that here it's easier to understand. You have your nilpotent orbit, you have your point here, and the tangent space here of at F of this orbit is in direct sum with this affine space. All right. This comes from the fact that this is a consequence of Jacobson-Morozov theorem that you have this decomposition. Okay, so intuitively you can think of this slice as it intersects like this orbit. So the intersection with this orbit in particular is just a point. All right. And then if you intersect with other orbit inside here, it's not anymore just a point, but you have still a sum which is equal to G. It's not a direct sum. All right, and now if I take what is usually denoted like this, the closure with this slice, this is the transversal slice at F in the closure. So this is how they appear in this context. Maybe I don't explain in details here, but you have a C star contract in action. So if you don't pick F in the closure, this intersection is actually empty. So this you can also define this intersection for any F, but it's not interesting at all if F is outside the closure. Okay, for the construction, so you can take this as a definition. So the geometry. Of this object has been mainly studied in the case where F is actually in a, what we call a minimal degeneration, but this means lying in the biggest orbit you can do here. I will explain in more detail, but has been mainly studied when. Precisely when GF is open in this complement. So in general, this can be a finite union of other nilpotent orbits. But the reason is that because this is exactly the singular locus, this means that you study generic singularities. So people interested in this mostly study in this case. In general, it's quite hard to study. So maybe I explain the famous case that you probably know. Best known cases. Okay, so the famous cases is the following. So it is well known that there is a unique nilpotent orbit which is dense in the nilpotent cone. So let O to be O red. So this is a unique nilpotent orbit of maximal dimension, and this one is dense in the nilpotent cone. And then There is also a property that if you do that, so maybe here just a nilpotent cone, and you remove this regular nilpotent orbit, here again there is a unique nilpotent orbit of maximal dimension which is dense here. And this one is called subregular. Alright? And then I pick F here in the subregular. And then it is well known that in this case, in this case, the corresponding nilpotent slot of this slice is a simple surface singularity. If you have already heard about this, otherwise it's not so important, but at least it is a surface with a simple singularities at F of the same type as G if G is simply less. So this is a Birkhoff's Slodovich theory which confirms a conjecture of Grothendieck. So probably you already heard about that, otherwise it's not so important, but usually people know that at least that case.
What's the subregular orbit in the
SLM? Yeah. Okay, yeah, maybe I should explain. I don't know how much you are familiar with. So then maybe I give an example in SLN and in fact in SL2, because this case is you know very well. Okay, so first of all, if G is SLN, which will be my main example throughout the talk, so it's a good example. So what is O reg? It's enough I choose one representative, and this is easy to understand. You take the full Jordan block. All right? And for subregular, so you know every nilpotent orbit has a representative which is a Jordan block, and here the Jordan block is just you have like this a block of type n minus 1 and then 0. And then, for instance, let's consider SL2. What is a nilpotent cone in this case? So first of all, I am in the traceless matrices. And here it's enough to ask that the determinant is 0. So you just have this. Okay, maybe I put x, y, small like variety. And then we recognize, for those who know this classification, it's a singularity of type A1. And SL2 has type A1. And in general, what you get, what you get for S, I don't know how to write, N.
Yeah, sorry, but here the subregular is just
that's a good point. Here, subregular is just 0. So the singularity is just as 0. But in general, you have more. So in general, what you get is a singularity. So SLN is type n minus 1. So in general, what you have, it's a singularity of this type at a point of subregular 1. All right? So here, for simplicity, I give for ADE. It is also well known for non-simply laced. It's still a type ADE. So you should explain how they use for type B, how it comes from type A and so on, but I don't explain this. You use the automorphism of the Dynkin diagram. It's already good to have this statement. All right, so this is what I say it's known, and another particular case is when you take the minimal one. Here again, there is a special nilpotent orbit. Okay, so at the extreme opposite, there is a unique nilpotent orbit, O min, of non-zero,
of minimal dimension. So for SLN, so either you think of Jordan Black block and there is only one block of size 2,2, or maybe it's easy to take just 0 and one element on the top. It corresponds to the highest positive roots. Okay. And then here what happens, here the closure is just this nilpotent orbit union 0. So here, if I take minimal degenerescence, you have just this, and so here you just get the closure of your nilpotent orbit. And this is, for this reason, when you have a singularity, you have a unique singularity at zero, and it is called a minimal symplectic singularity. Okay? So this is also interesting. Alright, so now I can collect what is known about minimal, I didn't say the name, but okay. So now the full classification, I don't know how to say.
For SL2, minimal and maximal is the same, right?
Yeah, for SL2 this is not interesting, this is just zero, maybe this does not have sense. For SL3, minimal one is the same as subregular. Okay, so so in fact, Kraft and Procesi in the 80s study all, here it's a bit more than what I say, they describe, don't know how to say, but all local geometry of these nilpotent slices, but here for any F, any O, in the classical case. Not exactly true, but at least they did the whole minimal one. There are some remaining cases which has been solved after, and they also study only to smooth equivalence, but recently this result has been improved in the sense that they really describe, I will go back to this for what I need, but for their purpose they describe a smooth equivalence, and their motivation came from the study of the normality of nilpotent orbit closure. This is why they wanted to study that. And for them, it was enough to study a minimal degeneration. And much more recently, Juto, Levy and Sommers, so this is 2018, did the same for, studied all pseudo-slices like this for minimal degeneration. So again, this means GF is open in the complement. And in general, it's still open to understand the local geometry of this. I mean, the local geometry of the closure and so the geometry of that. But they do at least all minimal degeneration plus a few cases. So this is very interesting. And so this is what is best known about this nilpotent pseudo-Dobie slice, but it turns out that they appear in various areas. Okay, just I comment also that these objects share a number of properties with the nilpotent orbit closure. So maybe I can mention, because there are some similarities, but also some differences.
Cases is codimension 2?
Ah, yeah, maybe I should have precise. This is what I won't explain now, but I should say before. So first of all, this one is always equidimensional, but not necessarily irreducible. Okay, it is if the closure of O is normal, which is the case in type A. But outside the type A, it may happen it is not irreducible, but at least it is equidimensional. And what I wanted to say, and of dimension, to answer your question, what is the dimension?
It is the dimension of the bigger one minus the dimension of that. Okay? So in particular, if O is O reg and O is O sub reg, then the dimension is just 2. So it is indeed a surface because it is well known that the subregular has co-dimension 2 is the reg. And for O min, so here I just have to give you the dimension of O min, and this is a nice formula. It's just 2HH minus 2, where HH, for those who know, is a dual Coxeter number, but for SLN, it's just n. For SLN, HH is just n. So there is a uniform description of the dimension of the minimal. Okay, so this is one thing. So this is one similarity, but also difference, because no need to be irreducible. It is smooth in codimension 1. It's normal when the closure is normal, and so on. And also, maybe I don't give detail for now, but this will be important for us. But this has a Poisson structure, which comes from the Poisson structure of G that I identify with its dual. So this is also interesting. Okay, so maybe I don't talk too much about that. So now, okay, so I say a few words about generalities, but so we just see that they appear in the theory of symplectic singularities. So this is maybe the more classical area where they appear. And now what I want to explain, so this will be at the beginning totally different topic, but they appear as associated varieties. Of W algebras, which are certain vertex algebras. And what is interesting is to use the geometry of these objects, and in particular works of Prochesi and Fu, Juto, and collaborators, to study some interesting problem here. And conversely, some of our results give new light in this classical theory. As I say, this is not known in general, and some of our results allows to describe this in a known case. So this is also interesting. And last thing, I don't talk too much today, but at least in the second talks, I think, it appears in physics in four-dimensional in equal to two superconformal theories, whatever it is, as Higgs branch of some Arduous Douglas theory, which is a particular theory of these theories. So this I will say a few words after. And these two facts are connected by a Higgs conjecture that I will explain a bit later. And our results are actually motivated by some conjectures here, but also by some more classical problems in representation theory of vertex algebras. Okay, so I think this concludes this first introduction to nipotence Lodovic slice, and now I change for a while the topic, but then we will go back to this when I explain what is associated variety. Is it okay for... So second part, so maybe I start with the definition of vertex algebra, so maybe not without too much detail, but at least I want to give a definition. So definition, a vertex algebra is a vector space, always over C in this talk, V, together with some data
vector. So the notation is strange, but usually it's called vacuum, and this notation is used. And you have also, which is the main ingredient, a linear map from V to the space of Lorentz series polynomials in volume in RV. So this is a linear. And you attach to any vector in your vector space V a series that I denote like this. So in this notation, An is an endomorphism of V. All right? So in fact, you can think of this as a residue of AZ multiplied by Vn, if you like. But this is a standard convention to write it like this. And then it is required that when applying this endomorphism to a vector B, this is zero for n big enough. So this means that when you apply this series to an element B, so you can form, you can put B here, then this has only finitely many negative terms. But the boundary depends on A and B. So you have to be careful that a priori the series belong to that. Okay? And of course, these data are submitted to some axioms. So maybe I need to explain. I am not writing maybe all, but almost. And then you have some axioms. So one important axiom is that you recover A from the field. The field, it's a series which satisfies this condition. So in fact, you can apply this field to the vacuum, so meaning that you apply An to this vacuum. And then, first properties, this belong not only to the V parenthesis 2 W, double parenthesis Z, but in the space of formal series with value in V. So then it makes sense to evaluate as Z is equal to 0. And then you recover A when you do that. So this is very important, and this is so-called the state field correspondence. So the knowledge of the field is the same as the knowledge of A. So what I'm saying is rather that it is injective, but in fact, there is really a correspondence. It's more difficult to understand, but at least it means that this map is injective. All right, and another important axiom is the locality axiom, which can be stated as follows. I now consider the commutation, let's say this. So if I put Z here and here, it does not make sense in general. But if I put different variables, this makes sense to ask whether you have this. So here you live in V with two variables. Huh? But this is a bit too strong conditions, in fact. So what is required? It is this is zero up to some power of Z minus W. Yeah. So for some n which depends on A and B.
So this I always get confused about. Could you explain right? The usually one can cancel Z minus W.
So maybe the basic example to be convinced that it's not always this.
For one, so far as your Lorentz series, are they always bounded in one?
No, a priori not. A priori not.
But then what does it mean, right?
Yeah, this means just I live in the ring of space of formal series, but when I apply to a vector, if I apply to some vectors, so this one, if I am correct, should live with that.
And this one should belong to that when I apply to some vector. And your question, yeah, maybe an example. It's not really an example of that, but just to show that it's not trivial to ask that you need to multiply by some power.
Over z.
Sorry?
The sum of n there is over z.
There is only one n here. Okay. I take it's connected.
Yeah, right. But this thing already, what's the meaning of it?
These belong to that. Just a formal power, but I don't claim convergency and so on, just formal. And then you write formally and you can check that this is you. So here you have, okay, it's not exactly the setting of that, but this means that you can have this zero without having this. It's not integral. You can be cancelled even if it is not zero. Yeah, so it's true that this is the most difficult action to understand, and usually when you study vertex algebra, you first try to find equivalent condition to that. So, okay.
Sorry, but so you're saying just this has nothing to do with this any like power series. So this thing doesn't make sense as a function anywhere.
This has no really meaning. You can think of the kind of Dirac because when z is equal to w, it's I don't know how to say, but this is not a function.
Yeah.
It's bad that the usual notation is that, but it's really bad because it's not a function. Mm-hmm. So it's just a notation, but it's true that this notation is not good, but it's a standard notation. Mm-hmm. So, so this locality axiom, okay, I don't want to give too much details, but because you introduce this, in fact, is equivalent, which is a bit better to understand, that you can write actually completely, and I mean completely, it depends on data, but you can write this bracket, and actually, if here it's n, you have something like that. Okay, so now I forgot the formula, but anyway, I'm sorry if I am wrong with constant, but roughly, it should be something like that. And then you have precisely this. It's not a function, but okay. And then you have something like that. Yeah, maybe I'm mistaken for the constant, but what is nice is that it's equivalent to something more concrete, that you can express this as a finite sum, which is, so there is coefficient, of course, which depend on a and b and n, that's natural, but which can be expressed in terms of this, this is called delta function, and its derivative. So this is a bit too heavy notation, so physicists like this notation, which is called OPE, and I will try to explain why it's interesting to write like this. So they just write like this, a, g, b, yeah, maybe they put omega, and then something like that. So we don't really care because this has no really meaning. It just expresses a singular part of that in the sense that this is a pole at z minus w and the rest is regular. But what is interesting for people who want to do computation is that the knowledge of this, and of course corresponding to the right power, is equivalent to the knowledge of all computation relations.
Okay, this is called Borchers identity. So you can think of this condition as a analog of Jacobi axiom for Lie algebra. So it is something which describes completely the commutator relation. And now I can even give you the formula. It is okay. Maybe I'm not sure I want to give the formula.
Well, why did you call the axiom?
It's a kind of axiom in the sense that you can replace this by this and another one. You can replace locality axiom by the fact that all commutators can be expressed like this.
No. Yeah, I agree completely. I don't understand the relation to Jacobi, but
okay. No, you're right. Not Jacobi. Sorry. To know the totally right. I mean, it's an analog to know the commutation relation in a Lie algebra.
Analog of structure constants.
Sorry. Or yeah. Sorry. It's structure constants. Totally. Sorry.
Nothing to do with.
Okay, so in practice, as soon as you know OPE is between generators in some sense, you can work in your vertex algebra. So this is okay, so as you see, this is not so nice. It's a quite difficult algebraic structure, but the point is that to any such algebraic structure, we can associate in a canonic way a much nicer object, which is just an algebraic variety. So this is very beautiful. So we will see an example right after I explain this, because then I can also explain what is the associated varieties in examples. Okay, so now the idea is that to any such vertex algebra, one can associate a certain algebraic variety, but which is even a Poisson algebraic variety, and in the following way. So I do in the faster way. I put RV to be the quotient, so a priori just as vector space, between some things that I can denote like that, where this is a vector span generated by vectors of these four. So you just kill here. I think in example it will be clear why we kill. Generators usually correspond to minus one, so it's kill first step. If I want to describe better, maybe I should introduce notation, but maybe for the moment, you can just trust my definition. So this is just a vector space, but what is very nice is that now this is naturally a commutative associative algebra. So to explain, maybe I should notice that there is a kind of product, which is not really a product, but what we call normally ordered product, which is just, okay, maybe I did not, I introduce it by the field, which is just the field corresponding to A minus 1 B. There is another definition, but you can define like this. But in general, this is not commutative. In general, this product, if you define as this, is not associative and is not commutative. But if you pass through this quotient, it becomes commutative and associative. So now RV is a Poisson algebra by, so the product, so I denote with the bar the image in in the quotient. So the product is the image of this in the quotient. And it is an exercise to show that this is a commutative and associative. So this is an exercise you cannot do, because we need to do the exercise, you need another Borchers identities, which is a bit more complicated, but there is a formula for such a thing. Huh? So this is one thing, and now I want to describe the Poisson bracket. And this is also an exercise that it is indeed a Poisson bracket. And here you take this image. And I should also give the unit, but this you can guess. It's just an image of the vacuum. So you have a nice Poisson algebra, and what is very good is that you see it's totally canonical. There is no choice of generators or so on. So this is very pleasant. And what is the associated variety is just the corresponding scheme.
Sorry, so the minus one thing, this is already regular or what?
No, what do you mean?
No, what I mean.
Ah, this is another story, actually. Because of this?
Yes.
Yeah, but this does not mean that a minus 1b is 0.
No, but I mean, but just to understand, so the minus 1 thing is a regular one, and 0 thing is the...
I'm not sure to understand the question, but...
I guess you tell this formula, right? And they correspond to the poles in z minus w.
Yeah.
If I substitute j equal to, actually here this minus 1.
Yeah, but here j is only positive.
So that has nothing to do with this.
Yeah, not really.
Wait, but then what is this a minus 1b?
When you have your series, So I just apply this coefficient to b. But maybe to relate to the axiom, I explained it is, you can obtain like this, but concretely it means that this is A minus 1 of vacuum, for instance.
But it's not really related to that.
No, I mean, but this is the same symbol, A, J, B.
That's it's the same symbol because all the time, this means I apply my endomorphism to B. In general, this makes sense.
Yeah. But they correspond to regular terms in the air. All what you are discussing now.
Yeah, this is not. This is this corresponds rather singular.
Those correspond to singular because 0 and minus 1.
I'm not sure how to relate to that. Minus 1 does not appear in this sense.
Yes, sum. But 0 appears.
0 appears. Yeah.
Okay. The minus one would be the first regular term.
The associated variety, you can take the corresponding scheme, but RV is non-reduced in general. It's very rare it is reduced. So it's convenient to take, because we need also only the geometry for the top, we take the reduced scheme corresponding to RV. All right, so by construction, this is a Poisson variety. And I assume that it is RV is of finite type, which will be the case in our example. So the idea is that this object captures many information about the vertex algebra V. For instance, if this one is just a point, it implies very strong property of your vertex algebras and so on. Maybe I don't discuss this now, maybe I want to give examples before we start this first part. So if time, I will give some properties, but it's maybe more important I give examples. Okay, so I give example in the context of Kac-Moody, the algebra. So this is called the corresponding vertex algebra, called affine vertex algebras. Okay, so let me introduce some notation. So G is as before a simple D algebra, and G hat. So you take the loop algebra here, plus an element like this. So this is my notation for G tensor So this is a polynomial in two variables. Huh? It's supposed to be finite in both sides. And with commutation relations, so first of all, k is central. And now it's enough I describe the commutation relation inside element in this part. And I like to write element, I hope the notation is okay. So this is my notation for x times x t. So this is x y, so this is a bracket in g, t n plus 1 plus m, Kronecker symbol of m n minus 1. So here you have a product, I will explain what it is, and you have k. And what is this product? It's a certain normalization of the Keeling form. So we already encountered the dual Coxeter number. All right, so for example, for SLN, this is very just the trace. And by construction, it's non-symmetric, G-invariant, and non-degenerate. You don't really need non-degenerate, but here I fix like this. Okay, so this is G hat, and now I want to construct a module of G hat, which will turn out to be a vertex algebra. Okay, so let's fix a complex number k, and then I denote by vkg the following induced representation. Okay, so here this is the subalgebra of my g hat, and here I tensor with ck. And what is ck? This is a one-dimensional representation of this subalgebra, where G, T act trivially, and K act as a K identity. Okay. Okay. So a priori, by construction, this is first of all a vector space, but also a representation of a G hat. Okay. And then it is well known that this has a structure, has a natural structure of vertex algebra. So let me explain a bit the structure. So first of all, the vacuum is just one. I don't know how to write this element, but I just take the image of one. And now, first of all, I would like to define the field corresponding to element of this form. So you see, I write this notation, but you remember what I wrote just before. A is supposed to be recovered by doing that. Huh? So this is a kind of, I can write by for short, Z if you like, and here X is in G. All right, and this field will be like that. Okay, I have to explain a bit. This, you remember, we want an endomorphism. So this acts on this just by multiplication by the left hand side. And maybe to explain why I'm considering this, and then it will be useful to understand the quotient. Note that this has vector space, is isomorphic by the Poincaré-Berkowitz theorem. By that, you cut all positive parts. So this means that elements are generated by, if you have a basis of G, you have a typical element like this.
So this is some kind of Verma module, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You can write all elements on your vertex algebra like that. So you see, you kill all positive things. Okay, so here I give the field only for, in some sense, some generators. In the sense generators, you see on this example that the basis of G is special in this representative. But of course, one may wonder what is the field.
field of that. There is a general theories for vertex algebra with strong generators in some sense, but on this example I can explain, and this is a very general. As soon as you have to be short a vertex algebra generated by such elements, so you have a generated set, here it's basis of G, then you can describe the field in general. But I'll just give you, just to make you safe, that we have the field for any element. Okay, so now you can compute so there is a formula like that. So the formula, there is a normally other product, but this is not so important. Maybe there are some factorial, but it's not so important. So normally the product is there just to make sense this product. All right, so this is the structure. And for our purpose, I want to describe the associated variety. So I need first to describe this quotient. And here, I consider the symmetric algebra, which is canonically isomorphic to the coordinate ring of the dual. And then we have the natural map from SG to this quotient. So this you can see using this description. It's not so easy with the definition I gave on ours, but okay, just so intuitively you cut each time the sum n1 plus etc. nr is greater than 1. So roughly, you keep only the term with minus 1 everywhere. So now you can imagine the morphism to a homogeneous element here you associate. Maybe I can just even give for x in G. You associate the image in the quotient. And this is actually an isomorphism. So this means that a Poisson structure, so this means that is actually isomorphic to that with the Poisson, with the constant Kirillov-Sourillon Poisson structure, with the standard Poisson structure.
It is Poisson structure, that's because you get this...
Yeah, that's exactly. In fact, okay, you can transport, but this is not how we want to prove it. Maybe I should say that here, A0, B for A, B in G, is just a bracket. And this, why? Because here, what is the OPE? So here, the OPE using this definition, You can use this and show that this is exactly A, B, W plus K, something like that. So in fact, OPE here are equivalent to the commutation relation on G hat. And there are many examples of vertex algebras which are actually generated by Lie algebra. So in fact, OPE is the same as commutation relation. So in fact, here the Poisson bracket, you can see directly.
Just a question, is it possibly a good time for a break?
Yeah, I think so. I'm sorry that I didn't go until W algebras in the first talk, but I have still 1 hour, right? Oh. So sure. So I'm sorry that I don't connect the two topics. So I hope to connect. But W algebras is more complicated because precisely they are not generated by Lie algebra. So I will not give even definition. So I'm sorry, but just to explain the construction and then we
We will see after the break example to connect with Slodovic slice. But we make a step because we are with the algebra. So.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Any questions or comments?
Is this associated varieties has some physics meaning? It seems that...
Yeah, exactly. I will explain that, but it depends. Sometimes it has a physical meanings. So I will explain after the break that in a recent conjecture, it can be interpreted as a Higgs branch of some theory coming from higher dimensional conformal theories. Maybe I should say, but vertex algebra correspond to two-dimensional conformal field theories. But recently, it appears that they are also connected with higher dimension conformal field theories. And sometimes these appear at Higgs branch. And this is one of the motivations of what I'm going to explain.
I mean, because it seems that you are passing from some conformal field theory to some community or classical mechanics things.
Ah, this I don't know for this in general.
Well, if not, thanks again.